Hello and welcome to Bell's Palsy Knowledge Base. Today we start the video post series, and the idea is to share with you the knowledge about facial nerve, facial palsy, about how facial muscles work, and what in particular can we do and should we do to reduce the residuals after Bell's palsy, and also to reverse as far as possible, as much as possible, its complications. The first post of this video series is about the facial nerve. Facial nerve, we can compare it easily to a thick telephone cable that connects the telephone station, which is our brain, with the neighborhood, which is our face. After leaving the telephone station, the cable divides. So the nerve provides signals to a various parts of the face through its branches. Then it divides again and provides signals to a single facial muscles. Then it divides even more and provides facial signals to a single muscle strands or muscle fibers. This way we can produce the whole variety of facial expressions, which is very rich, because our facial expressions, our facial nerve, has been perfected for the as a communication tool by millions of years of the evolution. It's interesting to know that our facial nerve is very thin. It's less than 1 millimeter thick. You can compare it with the thickness of a wire of this paperclip. It's very thin, but still it contains 10,000 nerve fibers, which otherwise are called axons. There are three sorts of neurons in the facial nerve: sensory neurons, parasympathetic fibers, and motor neurons. Sensory neurons provide electric signals to the taste sensors of our tongue. That's why when Bell's palsy happens, a lot of patients lose the taste sensation on one part of the tongue or have a weird taste sensation. Very often it precedes actual palsy. Parasympathetic fibers provide electric signals to our lacrimal gland, the gland that produces tears. That's also why when facial palsy happens, Bell's palsy that we are talking now about, the eye becomes dry, because the lacrimal gland does not receive any signals for tear production, so it doesn't produce any. And the last, and but not least, very important, are motor neurons. Motor neurons are effectively the neurons that provide electric signals from the brain to the face, the facial muscles, so we can move our face. Without these signals, no movements. So, as I told before, the motor neurons are combined in bundles, which are then divided into smaller bundles, yet smaller and smaller, until individual fibers reach muscles, muscle fibers, and they contract separately. But in perfect harmony, the signals reach our muscles, and we can produce our facial expressions, which are, of course, our very sophisticated communication tool. Let's talk about motor neuron construction. It contains three very important parts: cell body, which is called soma, dendrites or dendrites, which look like tree branches and help one neuron communicate with other neurons. And the last one is what's called axon, a very long so-called wire, which provides connection between the body of the neuron, which is located in the brain, here in the nucleus, and at the end with the muscle fibers. Axons actually are the highways which provide the way for the electric signals to pass from the brain to the face.